And if you notice, you should have got a bracelet when you came in. And that bracelet says something on there called pray first. And if you didn't get one, we'll have more outside, so I want you to grab one. But what kind of habit, if we can build the habit of praying first in our lives, what would our lives look like? And this is a good time to do it because, man, right now, January 8th, man, we got like New Year's resolutions are like popping, right? Like everybody's excited, like optimism's at an all-time high, like dreams or goals are ready to be rocked. Like we're pumped. Like this is a good time of year to do it. Unfortunately, like the 31st rolls around and that starts to look a little sketchy, right? Like you get in the end of the month or beginning of February, all of a sudden like New Year's resolutions become an afterthought. Dreams become wishes, like our optimism wanes, and we start drifting away from what we wanted to do. But what if this year could be different? What if dreams weren't just pursued, but we started seeing them become obtained? What if destinies weren't just something we wished for, but we actually started to see form in our life? What if we actually started seeing the progress of God in our life? That can be the reality for you. God wants to move in your life in ways you could never fathom. God wants to see you living your dreams. God wants to see you walking in that. And the reality is everybody has a dream. I have yet to meet someone that doesn't have a dream. Everyone has a dream. The unfortunate part is this, write this in your notes. Everyone has a dream. Very few people have execution. Like lots of people dream dreams. Very few people execute on those dreams. I've not met a person that doesn't want something better for their life. I've not met one person that doesn't wish to move forward. Like that could be in a career sense, like you want a new career, or you want a promotion, or you want to start a business or try something new. And a lot of times that's where we think dreams start and end. Like we think it's just career based. But it's much more than that. People dream about lots of things. They dream about being healthier. And so you have a dream to be healthier. Maybe you got a report from the doctor and you're like, man, I don't want that to be the final report. Maybe you're just not comfortable with where you are physically. And you're like, I want to move forward. Some people dream about having a healthier marriage or healthier relationships, period. Some people dream that their finances are going to quit controlling them and they're actually going to control their finances and they're going to get out of debt and know where their money's going. And some people just dream, they're like, man, I'm just tired of being spiritually bleh. Like, I'm tired of plateauing. I want to get closer to God. I want to dive into you. I want to build those habits and disciplines. Like, we all have dreams. Like, we all want something more in our life. But the reality is most people miss the most important ingredient when it comes to dreams. And I say this all the time, but write this in your notes. Dreams without discipline, that's fantasy. Like, you could dream all day long, but if you don't add discipline to it, you're in la-la land. It's fantasy. There is no such thing as overnight success. It doesn't exist. It's a myth. That's what late night infomercials are for. They tell you you can have instant results. It doesn't exist that way. Discipline has to be mixed to your dreams, and that's what turns dreams into reality. And I'm desiring to see that happen in your life. We're in this thing where I feel like 2017 is the year of growth for Bloom Church. And we've seen crazy amount of growth in 2016. God grew our church about 94% this year. We almost doubled in size. It's been crazy, but I don't mean physically. I mean God's wanting you to spiritually grow like never before. I believe God's wanting you to get roots deep in and start becoming who you were created to be. We saw over 601 people come to know Jesus last year in 2016, but I feel like God's about to take those 601 salvations and start defining destinies and building something in your spirit. And so I titled this message 1 year. 1 year is the message of the series. 1 year to shift your paradigm. 1 year, and a paradigm is a set of habits or patterns. And I believe to see the year of growth in your life, you've got to have healthy habits and healthy patterns, and God needs to shift something. And here's my challenge to every single person. Commit 1 year to it. Commit 1 year where you say, Pastor Mike, I'm going to commit to the process of Bloom. I'm going to commit 1 year solely to the process of Bloom. I'm going to get into a life group, and I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to go through growth track, and I'm going to learn what makes me tick. I'm going to learn what I'm created to be, and then I'm going to serve. And I'm going to be faithful in serving. I'm going to be faithful in bringing my kids here. I'm going to commit to the process. But I'm also going to commit to the process of the goals in my life. And I can promise you, if you commit 1 year, it is going to be a catalyst that's going to shift the paradigms in your life. And here's my guarantee. If at the end of the year you don't see growth in your life, I will personally help you find another church. That's my guarantee. I believe in it that much that I will personally help you find another church if you haven't seen growth. But you can't quit. You can't give up. You got to be committed. You got to put it all in. And this can be the year where growth takes place in your life like you have never seen it before. And so we've got a theme verse that's carrying us through this series, and it's this in Zechariah: do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin, to see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hands. Don't despise where you're at. God's excited about where you're going to go. And God's excited when you start moving forward. But he says something in here: to see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hand. A plumb line is a measuring tool. God loves it when you figure out the process to get you to where God has called you to be. And God loves it when you measure yourself along the way and you have a litmus test. And so I want you to understand that today. And so I titled this message today, Success, The Circle of Success. Because I believe success is not found in exact how-tos, it's found in understanding the process. Because when you get the process deep in your spirit, you allow God to reveal the how-tos and you will respond to them. But it is until you get the process in your spirit, you're gonna wander. And so today we're gonna break down what I call the circle of success, which is four phases. Now, I'm gonna get a little artsy with you today, as I got a dry erase board. And if you don't know anything about me, I have the most beautiful handwriting. Like, I'm a calligrapher. That's the way I do. Like, many times I'm writing and people go, is that your wife or your handwriting? Like, they can't even tell the difference. It's that good. And so watch, bear with me. I'm lying about all of that if you can't tell. But here's what we're gonna do. So the first thing I want you to understand about the circle of success is this. Write this in your notes. It starts with vision. The first thing you have to understand is it starts with vision. You gotta know where you're going. Like, you gotta know what the wins are in your life. Like, how do you know if you're successful if you don't know what success looks like? Like, how do you know if you're gonna be happy if you don't know what a happy, fulfilled life looks like? You gotta understand the vision, the purpose, the picture in your life. And this is the thing you must get. Write this in your notes. You don't stumble upon success, you purposely pursue it. You don't just happen to stumble upon being successful in life, you have a purpose and you're pursuing it. Yet too many times we just try to stumble upon successful moments in our lives and we don't realize that's not the way it works. It works when we actually try to discover what this picture is and pursue it. You gotta understand, life is a lot like a puzzle. You get a puzzle, right? And you have this. And all of a sudden, you dump out all the pieces right on the table. That looks like a whole lot of mess. Like, what is this supposed to even be? You look at all the pieces, and there's so much of it, and you don't even know what it looks like. And so many times, we look at life, and we're like, my life looks like this. Like, it's a bunch of pieces, but I don't know what it's supposed to be or what it's supposed to look like. What do you need to give you the vision? You need a box, right? You need the cover. You need to understand what this thing's supposed to look like. What is the objective? What's the goal? And God has a picture for your life. God has something specific for your life. And yet too many times we want to try to put a puzzle together without the box. And we're walking around blind and we don't know what we're tended to be or what we are supposed to be or what the vision for our life is. And so this is what you've got to get in your spirit. The first thing you need to know about vision is this: you were purposefully created. You were purposefully created. You're not an accident. You're not a mistake. You're not an afterthought. Like, God literally saw you and created you. So many times we think like God creates us and goes, you know, I better figure out something to do with these people. Like, you know, like I created them, right? Like, whoa. Or you become saved and you become a Christian. All of a sudden God goes, you know, I better figure something out so they look useful. That's not the way it works. He created you. You were purposely created. He saw you before you were ever born. Listen to what it says in Ephesians. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. This word, masterpiece, the original word actually means poema, which is where we get our word poem from, which means God beautifully described exactly who you are. It's beautifully crafted in description of who you are, and not only who you are, but who you were long ago. Jeremiah says, before you were in your mother's womb, he had a plan for you. He had an idea for you, which means that you are not here by accident. You're here on January 8th, 2017 in Branson, Missouri for a specific reason and a specific purpose. That God saw a need in this world and you have to fill it. That God saw people in this world and they know when you're living your vision and you're living your calling, their lives will be forever changed and impacted. That you have that much value to yourself. That your vision is that big. Yet we think it's not. And you got to understand something. You can't comprehend how big this vision is. Listen to what it says in 1 Corinthians. No eye has seen. No ear has heard. No mind can even imagine what God has prepared for those who love him. Like you can dream big and God dreams even bigger. You can see your potential and God sees even greater potential. That you can't even imagine the purpose and the life that God has for you. Your vision is huge. Unfortunately, none of us live that. Unfortunately, we just get by. Unfortunately, we are okay with the mess. And we don't even have the picture to go off of. And here's the reality. We let the lies of our insecurities cancel out our potential. Most of us in life will let the lies of our insecurities cancel out our potential. We let what frames our life be lies. And here's a headline for you. This is a big one. No one is great at everything. That doesn't exist. No one is perfect. No one has the exact same story as you. No one has the exact same opportunities. No one has the exact same timing. Like no one is perfect at everyone. Yet here's what we do. We take our greatest weaknesses and we compare them to people's greatest strengths. We compare our life to people's highlight reels. And then what we do is we walk in our insecurities. And we don't realize that those highlight reels have a backstory. Those home runs you see on ESPN, there were 7 other strikeouts that went before that. But what we do is we compare ourselves to the greatness and not to the weaknesses. And so what we do is we let our insecurities discount every potential that God has for us. Listen to what it says in Romans. In his grace, this word grace means divine power or divine enablement. God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. You are supernaturally gifted to do something well. You are supernaturally gifted to do great things. There are things inside of you that's greater than me. There's things inside of you could do that I can't even do. There is a huge vision that God has for your life, and he desperately wants you to understand it and walk in it. And listen to what it says here in Ephesians. It is in Christ that we find out who we are and what we're living for. It's in Christ that we discover who we are as people and what we're living for. Long before we first heard of Christ and got our hopes up, he had his eye on us. He had designs for us, glorious living. Part of the overall purpose he is working out in everything and everyone. God's got his eye on you. God's got a design for you. And it is in God you find out who you are and what you were created to live. It's in God you find out your vision. So here's your action step I want to give you. You need to go through Growth Track. You need to go through Growth Track. And if you don't know what Growth Track is, that's the classes we do every single month, the second and third Sunday of every single month, 2 p.m. right next door. You get me first week, so that starts today. But here's what we do at Growth Track. Growth Track's our membership class, but we don't do membership like most people. It's not a political thing. It's a vision thing. I want you to understand the process God has for every single believer. I want you to understand that God desperately wants every single believer to find Jesus, to find freedom, to find purpose, and to make a difference. And we talk about the heart and the structure at Bloom. And everything we do is to see people bloom into who they're created to be so you can find Jesus, find freedom, find purpose, and make a difference. And then in week 2, what we do is we give a personality test and a spiritual gifts test so you can find those things that you do well, and then you can help other people find Jesus, find freedom, find purpose, and then make a difference. And we're going to expand the kingdom of God and be the Great Commission Church that we were called to by Jesus. And that's the vision. You got to know it. You got to know the process. And so we've got our vision. Well, vision is displayed. Look at that good handwriting. Vision is displayed, write this in your notes, in your values. Successful people know who they are. Successful people know what they stand for. Successful people have strong values and strong character. And that values and that character is derived from the vision that has been given to you. What's the second thing you do after you dump out all the pieces on a table? What do? You start sorting it and looking for these edge pieces, right? You start looking for the edge pieces, and what do? You start building the border. You start framing this thing in. You start building this idea of what everything's gonna be contained in. Your values frame, they build this border around your dreams and your goals. And if you don't have godly values, you're gonna struggle. And this is what you need to understand. Godly success is framed in a godly mindset. Most people miss out on what God has planned for them because they don't have the mindset attached to what God has planned for them. They're thinking in the wrong way, and they're believing in the wrong way, and their values are shifted in things that are not rooted in God. And then they question and wonder, why do I keep missing? Why do I keep missing? Because your eye's not on the ball. Your eye's on everything else. You're scared of the picture. You're scared of the chances. You're scared of the crowd and what they're gonna think. And you're not rooted in who God says you are and your values. Listen to this. Write this in your notes. You can't have a dream bigger than yourself if you don't know who you are. You can't dream big dreams if you don't know who you are. And your values shape who you are. Because they shape who you are because you start seeing yourself the way God sees you, based on your vision. And so I believe there's four things that our values are rooted in. And I believe there's many more characteristics that are of God, but I believe everything comes from these four things. And the first thing you gotta understand, the first thing that is rooted in is faith. It's faith. That our first characteristic, our first value has to be a value of faith. Listen to what Hebrews 11:1 says. Faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about the things we can't see. So we gotta have faith that this vision's gonna actually take place in our life. Like, you wanna start a business, you gotta have faith that that business is gonna work, or that's pretty dumb to start that business. Like, you go into that business going, this thing's gonna fail, like, you shouldn't do it. Like, if you're gonna join a gym, you gotta have faith that you're gonna stick with it to keep it going. When I planted the church and there were 7 people in the living room, I had faith more people were gonna show up through our first service. Good thing they did. Not many more, but they did. Like, that was a faith. You gotta have this faith. And what is faith rooted in? Well, it says it like this. Our faith is rooted in this. All scripture. We believe the faith is rooted in the promises of God and the nature of God. And I'm old school here. I believe what Timothy says. All scripture is inspired by God. I'm old school, black and white. I preach the word of God. If it's in here, it's what we believe. We don't rip pages out of the Bible. We preach it. Now, there are things that culturally change, but the things that never have changed is morality, God's promises, and God's nature. They are forever and will never change. And so we believe the word of God. But watch what it says. Go back. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. Watch this. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. So God uses the word of God to prepare you to live the vision that God has for you, to equip you to be who you were created to be. Unfortunately, we know the word of God, we just don't always believe the word of God. Unfortunately, we're really good at knowing, we're not really good at living. Listen to what James says. James says it like this, for if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it's like glancing at your face in a mirror, you see yourself, walk away and forget what you look like. Did you get that? Your values represent who you are. But if you're not listening and believing the word of God, you don't know who you are. You see yourself and you forget your potential. You forget your design. You forget your intention. You forget the very person you were created to be, and you aimlessly walk this world. Hebrews says, for the word of God is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our inner thoughts and desires. The reality is you were created with a purpose. You were created with a design. You were created beautifully and sculpted beautifully. But then what happens is we allow things to layer over that. We allow the negativity that we think. We allow our doubts. We allow what culture tells us to believe. We allow what people have said to us. We allow our compromises. And they layer upon themselves and they hide the very being of who we're supposed to be. But the Bible says the word of God cuts through all of that. It exposes all of that and it brings out your potential and who you are called to be. And so when you read the word of God with faith and anticipation, all of a sudden your very nature, your very hope, your very being comes to the forefront and all that junk is wiped away because it cannot stand in the light of truth. That's what it believes. So we have faith. And because we believe in the promises of God, and we believe in the nature of God, we also walk in favor. Because we believe those promises and that nature reflects and are for us. We have the favor of God. Watch what it says in Hebrews 11. It goes on to say, and without faith, it's impossible to believe God. So without believing the word of God, it's impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists. Watch this. And that he rewards, that he blesses, that he has favor for those who earnestly seek him. That the word of God says that when you believe the promises of God, you see the promises of God in your life. When you earnestly seek the nature of God, you experience the favor of God. Listen to what it says in Psalms. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Goes on to say in verse 84, 11, it says, for the Lord our God is sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. So God doesn't withhold anything from you. And so I have faith that the word of God is true and that the nature of God is true. And because I have faith, I walk in favor and I see the miracles unfold in my life. And because I have favor and no miracles will unfold in my life, I will walk into the unknown and have fortitude and grit and resolve to keep going because I know that the promises of God are true and I walk in the favor and the nature of God. I put action to my dreams. I have the resolve to keep going. Unfortunately, we like to be those couch Christians. We like to pray and believe, but we don't ever want to get off the couch. And the only thing that gets you is a booty indention on your couch. It does not get you your destiny. And you gotta understand this, write this in your note or read this in your notes. Lazy people want much, but they get little. But those who work hard will prosper. Lazy people, they want it all, but they don't get nothing. But man, when you work hard, you'll prosper. And that's why it says work brings profit, but mere talk leads to poverty. And so all of a sudden, I've got faith that the promises of God are true and the nature of God is true. And because I believe they're true, I believe they're for me. And so I'm gonna walk in favor and that favor is gonna produce miracles in my life. And because I believe miracles are gonna go in my life, I'm gonna have the fortitude to step into the unknown, to work hard and to put action to my faith. And because I believe that God's gonna do what he says he's gonna do and I have favor and I'm walking in the unknown, I'm gonna have fulfillment that no matter what this world brings my way and no matter what people say about me, God always has my best intentions at heart and I am protected in the palm of God's hand. So what can anybody do to me and what can this world do to me and how can it ever stop my dreams and destiny? Because the promises of God are true. I have the favor of God. I walk in the fortitude of God and now I have fulfillment in my life. That's the values you're rooted in. That's what frames you. You got to walk in that. Listen to what Romans 8:28 says. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. He causes everything. I know I'm giving you a whole lot of information, but hopefully it's good. Hopefully it's impacting you. I want the word of God to speak to you today. I want it to be more than my words, okay? Listen to your action step. Commit to prayer and Bible readings daily. You got to get this in your spirit. If the word of God exposes your very nature, if the word of God literally gets you to your purpose, and the word of God is the promises of God and the reassurance of God, and that's where favor's found and fortitude's found and fulfillment's found, then you need to get it in your spirit every single day. And then you need to pray and proclaim those things every single day. You got to start replacing the lies with the truth. And that needs to become a daily habit. All right, so we've got vision displayed in our values. Well, values influence. Values influence, write this in your notes, our goals. This is where you get nitty gritty. This is where action starts to take place. Watch this. So you're building the frame. You got the frame completely built. What do you do next? You got to start working on all the details. You got to start getting all the inside pieces put together. And what happens? The deeper you get into this, what are you going to need? You're going to need to go back to the original picture. You got to remember what this thing's going to look like. And here's what happens. Here's what happens. Many times we got a dream and we want to go straight to the goals, but we don't have the character and the nature to get these goals accomplished. But when you have the right nature, your goals are influenced by that, and that nature is displayed by your vision, so you have a clarity in completing the goals that God has for you in life. You can't skip a step. You got to dream like God. You got to have the character, faith, favor, fortitude, fulfillment. That's how you're going to start seeing goals become more than just words, but action. That's how you put feet to your dreams. Listen to what James says. So you see, faith by itself isn't enough unless it produces what? Good deeds. Good deeds are found in good values, good nature, good character. And it's dead and useless if it's not producing something. And so we're going to have faith attached to this. And this is what you've got to understand. A legacy is earned by those who are willing to work hard. Legacies are earned. And you're called to leave a legacy on this world. You're called to make a difference. Inheritance are given, legacies are earned. And God's calling you to be a legacy builder. God's calling you to live a life before. And that's why Colossians says, whatever you do, whatever, work at it with all your heart, as though you were working for the Lord and not for people. And this is where most people stop. This is where most people give up in your goals. And this is why. They're not willing to do whatever you do, work as it. You got to understand the majority of your goals at this phase are pre-dreams, not post-dreams. It's easy to work towards your goals when you're living your dream. It's hard to work towards your goals before your dreams ever become fruition. It's easy to work on your marriage when everything's great. It's hard to be the spouse you're called to be when your marriage is on the rocks. But that's the goals you have to have. Whatever you do, work as though you're working for the Lord. It's easy to work your job and have goals in your jobs when you're living your dream. It's hard when you're working a 9-to-5 and it's not what you're called to do. But that's what 7-to-2 is for. Because you're willing to put in the pre-goals so you can live your dreams. It's easy to go to the beach with a 6-pack abs. It's hard to get in the gym when you ain't been in there in 2 years. And you got to work through the pain and get through that stomach cramps and feel this muscle soreness. You got to have the fortitude that, like Colossians says, whatever you do, that I'm willing to have the pre-goals before I live the pre-dream so I can see it become reality. And this is what you got to understand. Write this in your notes. Dreams are conceived on your knees and they're achieved on your feet. When you're seeking God, he gives you this vision. And he defines your values. But this is you. This is where you take your vision, God's values, and you start doing it. And too many times we think dreams are handed, dreams are worked for. Noah didn't pray a boat into existence when God called him to build one. He spent 150 years building it. Abraham, when God said, I'm telling you to go to a new land, he didn't just pray and then was magically teleported to that new land. He literally picked up his family. He walked into the unknown. He literally went through treacherous terrain. He had to go through foreign countries with foreign leaders. Joseph, when God said, I want you to take over the promised land, didn't just walk in and the cities were empty. He had to fight his way through. And God's saying, you've got a city. You got a promised land. You got a calling. You got a dream. But are you willing to fight for it? Are you willing to put in the grit, the resolve, the hard work? Because dreams are not achieved when you just wish, hopefully. They're achieved when you get on your feet and start moving towards it. Where do you want to be a year from now? Where do you want to be 3 years from now? Where do you want to be 10 years from now? How do you want your life to look at the very end? That's the way you dream. Unfortunately, here's what I get a lot from people. Pastor Mike, I know God has a vision for me, and I know godly values, but I don't really know what my dream is. I don't know what God wants to do in my life. I don't know what I'm supposed to have. I don't know what this thing's supposed to look like. We got to get our childlike faith back, church. Do you know when they test kindergartners right before they go into school, over 90% of them test as creatives? But then when they bring that same test into high school years, it's less than 20%. What changes? We quit dreaming like kids. We start letting culture tell us what's rational, what's true. You got to have a childlike dream. And here's how I tell people to dream. If money and time were not an object, what would you do for the kingdom of God? Can you imagine if you dream like that? Because money's not an object to God. And time is not an object to God. So if money and time were not an object, what would you do? Dream like that. Because I guarantee you all have something inside of you that you could answer that one. And I guarantee you if you prayed and you said, you know what? People's opinions and people's time and people's money, none of that hinders what God wants to do in my life. And then when you get that picture in your mind, here's what I want you to do, action step. Write this in your notes. Set a maximum of 6. No more, just a maximum. Don't go overboard. Measurable goals that you will accomplish in 6 weeks. Set a maximum of 6 measurable goals that you'll accomplish in 6 weeks. You gotta start taking steps. If you wanna lose weight, what do? You join a gym, you get an eating plan, you're gonna set out how many days you're gonna work out a week, you're gonna drink a certain amount of water, you're gonna get an accountability partner, and you're gonna say, I wanna lose X amount of weight, pounds, in this 6 weeks. Guess what happens at the end of 6 weeks? You have something to measure. Did I join a gym? Did I set up an eating plan? Did I go that many times a week? Did I drink that much water? Did I talk to my accountability partner? Did I lose that weight? You can measure your progress. Here's what happens. We got a dream. We set no measurable goals. And then we wonder why our dreams never happen. Because you got to take a step up the stairs to get to the top of the stairs. Set measurable goals. And lastly, and I'm going to end with this. Your goals drive. Your goals drive, write this in your notes, your destiny. Your goals drive your destiny. And your destiny reflects your God's vision. Your destiny is when this thing starts to come together. And it may not be completed, but it starts looking a whole lot like this. And all of a sudden, you're getting excited because you start seeing yourself becoming who you are always intended to be. And you got there because goals fueled that. And your goals were influenced by your values. And your values were displayed in God's vision. And now your destiny reflects the very vision that God has had for you all along the circle of success. Watch what it says in Leviticus. I will look favorably upon you, making you fertile and multiplying your people. And I will fulfill my covenant with you. You will have such a surplus of crops. Watch this, that you'll need to clear out the old grain to make room for the new harvest. I will live among you. I will not despise you. I will walk among you. I will be your God and you will be my people. This is an Old Testament covenant. But you know what Jesus said? He said, I didn't come to do away with the Old Testament. I didn't come to do away with the old law. I came to fulfill it. And Jesus says, I complete this covenant. I complete this promise that there is gonna be a day when you have to move out and get some space because the harvest is gonna be so great. And I'm gonna do so much in your life. And you're gonna literally see me walking with you and being with you. And my spirit's gonna be manifested through you. And you're gonna walk in faith. You're gonna see favor. You're gonna walk with fortitude. You're gonna literally have fulfillment. And I'm gonna take you from a vision to a destiny. You are gonna reflect the very nature of who you're created to be. You gotta do it. So here's my action step for you. I will commit my life to the process of God. I'm gonna commit. I'm not gonna quit. I'm not gonna give up. I'm gonna quit Because Philippians says, I am certain that God who began a good work within you will continue his work until it's finally finished. That God's gonna finish this vision in your life. If you don't quit, if you don't give up, if you keep pushing through. Let me end with this quote and I'm done. Earl McManus said it best like this. God is continuously inviting us to believe that his future is better than any past that we have experienced with him. Can you believe that the glory of the present moment can be greater than the glory of your best memory? Can you believe that your best days are not gone? Can you believe that God's greatest miracles still haven't been seen in your life yet? Can you believe that this can be the catalyst where you start seeing something you've never seen in your life? Because that's the reality. God's not done with you. God's not finished. And he wants to display something in your life that you can never imagine. Give me 2 minutes, I'm done. No packing your bags, because this is the most important thing I can do. Because there's people in this room that says, Pastor Mike, all this sounds great, but I'm not even living this vision that God has for me. Because I have no relationship with Jesus. I haven't committed my life to Jesus. He hasn't revealed this to me yet. I'm struggling because I'm living for everything but God. But the Bible's very clear. The Bible says that when you commit your life to Jesus, you become his child. You become his son and daughter. You become his heir. And you know what that means? That he gives you this godly vision. He gives you the fact that you are to be free. The fact that you have a purpose and that you can make a difference. And the Bible says that if you confess your sins with your mouth, if you tell God you need him in your life and you want to have a relationship with him, and then you believe in your heart that he literally died, he literally rose from the grave, and he literally washes away all your sins, all your mistakes with his blood. If you believe that he actually forgives you, then you're instantly saved. You're instantly his son or daughter. And you may think that sounds way too easy, but grace was never meant to be hard. It was just meant to be chosen. And don't go one more moment without choosing God in your life, without committing your life to God, because it's there vision shifts to values. Values shift to progress, and progress lets you live your destiny. I want everybody right now to bow your heads. I want nobody looking around. And I want every single one of us in this room to repeat this prayer. Dear Jesus, I have many mistakes in my life, but you still love me. You still pursue me. And today, I'm committing my life to you. I believe you died on the cross. I believe you rose from the grave. And I believe your blood washes away all my sins. I am forgiven. I am chosen. I matter.
Hi, family. We hope you enjoyed this week's message, and we pray that it spoke to your heart. If you made a decision today to follow Christ, or maybe you recommitted your life to Christ, we want to hear from you. Send us an email at connect@bloomhere.org. so that we can send you the next steps in seeing you bloom into who you were created to be. You can also connect with us on our website, bloomhere.org, or visit our Facebook page, Bloom Church, or Twitter and Instagram, @churchbloom. We look forward to hearing from you. We love you, and we'll see you next week.